Welcome to Author Author. My name is Sven Michael Davison, and today I have writer and journalist Greg Nichols talking about his book, Striking Gridiron. He'll talk about how he found the story, how he investigated it, and how it became a proposal, and how that proposal evolved, and then ultimately became a published book. So don't forget to subscribe, and here we go. Welcome to Author Author. I'm here with Greg Nichols, and we're here to talk about Striking Gridiron. So if you can describe it for me, I'd love to hear about it.
Sure. So Striking Gridiron is a narrative nonfiction book. It's about a steel strike in 1959, which was the largest industrial work stoppage in the nation's history. To this day, that's still true. 500,000 steel workers walked off the job. And during that strike, like corresponding almost to the day, it was a three-month-long strike, was the high school football season. And in this town called Braddock, Pennsylvania, which was home to Andrew Carnegie's first steel mill, there was this team that had gone five seasons without losing a game. On the eve of the sixth season, if they successfully won every single game, they would break the national record for consecutive games without a loss. So Sports Illustrated came down, and there was just a ton of national media attention around this scrappy group of steel town boys. And the book is about that season set against this strike in the backdrop when all of the families, the team members, were out of a job.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So what was the genesis of it? I mean, how did you hear about the story? How did you end up pursuing it? I mean, I'm just kind of curious.
Totally. A little bit of like a convoluted story, I guess. So it started in grad school. I got my MFA at Emerson College and got MFA in creative writing. I went in as a fiction writer, and somewhere along the way, thanks to a couple just like amazing professors, my whole world was shattered and nonfiction became this like this, I don't know, this incredible outlet for narrative. Like something about being able to arrange facts in a constellation of like an arc of a narrative really appealed to me. And something about the fiction had always felt a little bit unmoored. Like I read kind of widely and voraciously. I wasn't really sure what kind of stuff I wanted to write. When I found nonfiction, it was just like, it totally appealed to me. So I was in grad school going down to Braddock, Pennsylvania for a completely different reason. They had at the time, this was like in 2009, 2008, they had, no, before that, yeah, 2009, 2008, they had a new mayor, John Fetterman, who was this like big dude, 300 pounds, 6'8", tatted up, came into this Rust Belt town. At this time, Braddock had lost like 90% of its population, just a total Rust Belt victim. And the mayor was getting tons of national attention for bringing in like some new blood, young like artsy types who were doing cool art projects and rejuvenating the town in different ways. So like Rolling Stone and the New York Times Magazine, they came down and he got these huge profiles. He was on the cover of The Atlantic. And I was like, what is going down here? I got to figure this out. I remember thinking someday I'm going to have like the perfect opportunity to just like just go pursue my interest and fly down to a town and like investigate. I was like, oh shit, I'm like in grad school and this is the perfect opportunity to do that. And I just made this turn toward nonfiction. So I took the opportunity to go down there and I was kind of looking for like the bigger story to see like what was really happening down here or like if this was going to be like a longer narrative I could pursue. And I got hooked, and so I kind of kept coming back. The people I met were amazing. It was the scene down there was a little bit more complex than had been portrayed in some of the media. There was a lot of like antagonism locally, a lot of infighting between longtime locals and some of the newer residents. So I just kind of kept following the story, and I spent like a month down there during the summer, 1 month, and again, just kind of kept coming back. Anyway, that was going to be my first book, like the story of this town and like this like potential Rust Belt Renaissance with like possibly a twist. And I really tried hard to interest agents in that book. And I got a lot of bites and I made some progress. No one ever bid on that book. There was just like it always didn't quite fit the mold of what an agent thought would be a successful book. So fast forward maybe a year or two later, I kind of gave it another go and found an agent who saw something in one of the chapters that I was proposing that might be a bigger story, and that was the chapter of this 1959 incident with a high school football team. And so it was really, I kind of sat back and thought, like, am I gonna stick to my guns and try to write this book that I've been pursuing, or am I gonna pivot and see if this is a story I can enter? And I decided to make that pivot, and I ended up signing with that agent. We ended up developing that into a book proposal, and that became Striking Gridiron.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So the agent signs you based on that one chapter, and you basically saying, yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah, I mean, it was, I don't know, the agent process, and I don't know how familiar your viewers are with that whole thing. It's
well, pretend like they don't know, so go ahead.
Yeah, okay, cool. Like, and it's hard to get that information, how to actually find an agent. So first of all, I found an agent by looking on Publishers Marketplace, which is this like subscription service for publishing industry people that basically lists all of the book deals that come down the line, and it's searchable. It's like a $20 per month thing. So I subscribed for 1 month and then promptly unsubscribed once I had my list. But you can search all the book deals. So you can search like nonfiction, and then like I don't know, sports or whatever, and kind of figure out what the deals are. It says who the acquiring editor is. It has information about the agent, and it has information about like the scope of the deal sometimes. And that's just like this trove of information. So all of a sudden, you compile this list of agents that are potentially interested in your type of book, or have at least represented that type of book before. So I started with that list, and that's kind of what I was working down. And then I was sending query letters, and when that agent bit a little bit, it was probably another like 6 or 8 months before we actually signed, because it's just this proofing period. Like, who am I? I hadn't written a book before. I had some magazine stuff under my belt, but there was no book. So, I was sending her material, I was developing outlines, and we were really working together, and it wasn't, again, until 6 or 8 months later when she was like, okay, I'm in, let's do it. And I signed, and then we finished the proposal and took it out.
So the proposal, did she kind of walk you through that, or had you already like read up on that, or I mean, how did you kind of craft that?
I asked some professors in grad school for their proposals. And like that, again, it's hard to find out what that consists of. Like, what is a book proposal, and what is a nonfiction book proposal, and what is this specific type of nonfiction book proposal? So I was asking people I knew through school, and then all like people I knew outside of school, and so I had a few examples, and then she sent me some proposal she had developed, and then definitely there was a lot of hand-holding on her part walking me through that. It's funny, like to get the agent, you do the query letter, but you also do like, you take a crack at a proposal at a certain point. Like the query letter is like, hey, can I send a proposal? And then you have what you think a proposal looks like. And then if you're lucky, an agent says, this looks great. Now let's like take it all apart and completely redo it.
Right.
And that's kind of like the desired outcome.
And I'm kind of curious, you got proposals from your professors.
Yeah.
And you got a proposal from your agent.
Yeah.
How similar were those proposals?
The proposals I've seen, and now I have friends that are doing the same thing, there's like a drastic span, like the spectrum of what they look like is pretty wide. So I think a lot of it has to do with agent taste and what they think is going to appeal to an acquiring editor at a publishing house. But like in general, like there's kind of a, like the nuts and bolts of it are the same. There's always like, you know, chapter summaries, and there's like a marketing plan, there's sample materials, comparable titles, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then how long was it between the time you got the proposals from your professors and the time you actually submitted a proposal to, you know, editors?
So in grad school, that was that first attempt to sell the Braddock book, you know, the original Braddock book. And then it wasn't until, it was probably a year later, I was living abroad when I did that second attempt. And that's when I got the agent. So, there was a decent span there between those two things, for sure.
Yeah. And then how long did it take from the time you submitted the proposal to editors to the time you actually got, you know, a deal?
A contract? It's quick. It's like 2 or 3 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
Actually, I have a proposal that went out yesterday, so I'm waiting. So
nice.
If I get a call like right now in the middle of this, I'm going to answer it.
I don't blame you. We'll listen in.
Yeah, for sure.
Awesome.
Please subscribe so my dad can make more videos like this. Thank you.